Hi, everybody. I'm Paula Haddock. I'm with Colorado's Best. I'm the host of Colorado's Best. It's such an exciting night here. We are broadcasting to you live. We're video streaming live to you in your homes. I just love that we can do this. I am here with Joseph Quijano because this is the Become the Banker. This is a free event. It is a packed house inside here tonight. Luckily, you are watching it from the comforts of your own home. But Joseph, Become the Banker is such an incredible financial concept. You've been a certified financial planner a long time. And tell me a little bit about that.
Well, I mean, I was actually certified in 1991, Paula. But I started my career in financial planning in 1974. That's over 40 years ago.
For 40 years.
That I've been helping people achieve their dreams financially.
And nothing has excited you more than this Become the Banker concept.
Absolutely not. This is the best financial concept that I have ever in my life seen. It stops people from losing money. It offers a guaranteed rate of return. Mm-hmm. And it's tax-free. And you can use your money with no penalties. How good is that?
It's incredible. It's incredible. I've been doing this for more than 7 years now. That's when I came to one of your free events as well. I came by myself. I was so excited by what he teaches people. I ran home. I got my husband, and I brought him back for another event. So they're almost ready for Joe, so I'm going to let you go in just one second. But I just wanted to say that we've been doing this. It's such a profound impact on our lives financially. So thank you.
Oh, you're welcome.
Thank you so much. I'm going to let you go. So I know a lot of people want to learn the same thing that I have learned over the last 7 years.
Wonderful. Okay. Thanks again.
We'll see you inside. Bye-bye. All right. So I have been talking to some of the people out here in the hallway. I want this couple to step in. They impress me so much because you're so young. Tell me your names first.
I'm Marcus.
Okay. I'm Jamie.
All right. In your early 20s, right?
Yes. I'm 23.
Tell me what brought you all here tonight.
Basically to try to figure out a way to secure my financial future, and I thought this would be an interesting thing to learn. Just sounded interesting when I saw it on TV.
Yeah, I'm so impressed at someone in their young, 20s. You're already concerned and planning for your financial future. Bravo! Mm-hmm. And you, young lady, graduate school, I think you told me.
Yeah, I'm right at the end of grad school, so about to start my career. And that's something we talk about a lot: is working hard in school and then just wanting to be able to enjoy the money that we make and kind of be smart about it. So,
yeah. All right, that is smart. You guys are so smart for being here tonight. Bravo! Right. High five! High five! We'll see you inside.
All right,
thanks a lot. And Maxine. Totally. I want to hear your story, why you came here tonight. You said you've been wanting to come for a while. Let's step back this way.
Okay. Yes, I've been really looking for some strategies on investments and how to grow the money, little money that I have. I'm close to retirement now, and I have about 2 more years, and I want to be able to make some wise decisions on the monies that I do have.
Yeah. I'm so glad that you're here tonight because I've said this before. It has just been a profound improvement on my financial life. And it's been a short amount of time. In just 7 years, made a big difference in my life. So I'm so glad that you're here tonight. And I'm glad to see so many people here tonight. So thank you. And we'll let you go back in there.
All right.
Hearing a little bit of feedback from some of the live shots. So that's really, really cool. It seems like a lot of people around the hallways here are streaming us live. Hi, it's Dave, right?
Right.
Okay, I just met you coming in. Tell me why you came here tonight.
Well, everybody's looking for somewhere to put their money to get some kind of a good investment return. Yeah. And that's what you're hoping to find.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So, so many people, they look at 401ks, IRAs, things like that. But we know at the end of the, after we've saved all that money in the 401ks, we're going to have to pay taxes on it, right?
Correct.
At some point, you got to pay Uncle Sam. What I love about what I've learned here is this is a place where you can put your money, it grows tax-free, and then when you come to get it out, you still don't pay any taxes on it. How's that sound?
That'd be fantastic. Yeah.
Well, that's what you're going to learn. That's what I learned more than 7 years ago. So, Dave, I'm going to let you go inside and listen a little bit more and figure this out for yourselves. It's very exciting.
Okay. Thank you.
I love talking to the people out here. Everyone has a different why factor, Patrick, is that right? Okay.
Yes.
I'm meeting a lot of people here tonight. So tell me a little bit about what is your why factor, Patrick?
I'm interested in learning how whole life insurance policy can become a very powerful investment tool. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It really is incredible to me that people, you know, they look for so many different ways, of saving money. But, you know, they think of, I'm going to put it in the stock market. But the stock market goes up and down. And, you know, it's just an emotional roller coaster as well as a financial roller coaster in the stock market going up and down. But when you put your money into this kind of account, it's safe. It's been around for more than 100 years, right?
Right.
And it's tax-free. I mean, that seems to be a real winner for so many people, that it's tax-free, right?
Tax-free, that's a very big deal. And I'm very curious in how all that works and mm-hmm. comes together, because this I'm looking at how do you weather the storms mm-hmm. and how do you go through the calm times as well that our country goes through and our economy.
Yeah, because as we know, it's never the same, right? It's just like the weather outside. The one thing you can count on is it's always going to change, right?
Yes.
Patrick? Well, I'm so glad you're here tonight. I'm so glad. It's a packed house. I know we saved a spot inside for you, though, so you're good to go.
Thank you very much.
We really appreciate it. Thank you so much. All right, it's getting really close to time now, and I want to just thank everyone for being here. Thank you at home for watching. I think you're going to be so excited. I know I am, that Joseph is ready here to teach you what he has taught me and so many other people to really just improve their financial lives. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Joseph Quijano.
You know, I want to welcome you tonight to the Become the Banker seminar. And I also want to welcome the people watching at home through our live streams. And what I'd like you to know is that even though we're filming, they're not really filming you, okay? You're going to just get filmed probably the back of your head. They're just filming me and actually some of the PowerPoints that we're going to be showing you. Fair enough? Now, you may be wondering, what is Become the Banker? Why did we choose the name Become the Banker? Well, let me just set your mind at ease. You don't have to be a banker. You don't have to go to school to become one. It is only the name of a very powerful financial strategy that is helping people achieve their financial dreams all over the country. And it can help you do the same. So let me ask you a couple of questions. Are you happy with the economy over the last 10 years? You know, if you look at the stock market, what it has done, we have met with people that have lost a lot of money because of the fluctuations of the stock market. If you look at banks, they're paying us, what, less than 1%? So where's people to go nowadays to make any money? So do you agree that we need some change? We need to change. In order to get ahead financially, we need to change. Because we can't keep doing the same things that we have been doing in the past. They're not working anymore. You know, the financial tools that we used in the past are not working today. So we have to do something differently. Do you agree with that? But that requires change. And change, for all of us, is difficult to make. Let me show you an example. I know you're eating, some of you, but take your hands out like this and outstretch them. And what I want you to do is I want you to clasp them. Now do it again. Do it again. And do it again and hold them right there. I want you to notice where your thumbs are. Is the right over your left or the left over your right? It doesn't matter, okay? But what I want you to do is I want you to please do it again, but switch thumbs. Difficult, right? It's difficult. That's change. And so it is with our knowledge, our financial knowledge. We have to change. Now, what I want you to do is I want you to see the PowerPoint. Can you see it from here? All right. Become the banker. You will achieve financial security for life, guaranteed. If you take a look at this castle, look at the bags of money. This is what we're trying to do. We're trying to build money. Am I right? But you see that cannon right there? Because we have to protect our money from four thieves. There's four thieves. One of them is the greedy bankers. We lose a lot of money to banks. The second thief
I hate to say this, but it's the government. The third thief is ourselves. And the fourth thief is actually Wall Street. Those four thieves will deplete your money supply. And this is what's happening today. So we need to protect against those four thieves. So the objectives for tonight, they're very simple. We're going to teach you how to protect your money from the four financial thieves. Number two, we're going to help you learn to teach you, or we're going to teach you how to make your money work for you, not against you. See, that's the key to making money, making your money work for you. And number three, hugely important, we're going to encourage you, we're going to motivate you to pay yourselves first. That's one of the key elements of building wealth. Now, I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself. There's thousands and thousands and thousands of financial planners. So why would somebody like you choose somebody like me? I want you to get to know me. I was born in Mexico City, the biggest city in the world. And I came from very humble beginnings. So if you want to know about somebody that had nothing to begin with, it's me. My sister got married to an American doctor, and they brought me here. They brought me to Iowa. I went from the biggest city in the world, which is 23 million people, to the smallest town in the world, Greenfield, Iowa, 2,500 people, when I was 12 years old. What I learned is that this country offers an abundance of opportunities if you're willing to take advantage of them. I work really hard, two or three jobs, shoveling snow in the winter times, working on a farm, picking up hay, working at the Super Value store in Greenfield, Iowa, and I was able to save money. And I was able to invest money with some help. I was supposed to go back to Mexico within 6 months, but I fell in love with this country because of what it offers. So what I did is I joined the United States Air Force, and I defended this country during the Vietnam era. I was honorably discharged, and I became a citizen of the United States. And I promised myself that I would actually become a financial planner to help people reach the American dream again. I had the opportunity to do that. I became a homeowner many times over. I own my own business. I actually do businesses. But what I noticed from my beginning here to when I was honorably discharged is that people that are born here could not really reach that dream. Did you ever wonder what makes people financially successful and other people struggle? That's been a question for me. So I wanted to find out. So I actually went to college for that. I went to that college for financial planning, and I graduated from that college, and I became certified. There's a big difference between a financial planner and a certified financial planner. A certified financial planner, you have to take, it's like a master's degree, and you have to take an exam that is actually like the bar examination for a lawyer. That's what a certified financial planner has to go through. We have to adhere to a code of ethics, and we're monitored by the CFP board, the financial planning board, and we have to have education every 2 years, 30 hours of continuing education. So not everybody is a financial planner, okay? Not everybody is. So you can actually check us out. You can see that we did graduate from the College for Financial Planning. We're in the Better Business Bureau. We're an A+1 company with them. And we're really fortunate to be Colorado's best financial expert. Excuse me. I mean, this is hot lights over here. All right. And that's one thing that I really, really, really am proud of, because they could have chosen anybody to be their financial expert. They chose me. Now, again, you can check us out by going to cfp.net, type in my name, Joseph Quijano, and you will get this report right there. And I know it's kind of hard to see, but we included one on your packet. But one thing that I want you to notice is that since 1990, we haven't had one complaint. Not one complaint. And we haven't had any financial difficulties. And that to me means a lot. So reputation that you can trust. We have education. We have ethics. And we have experience. Is that pretty good, you think? Okay. So let's talk about the four thieves right now. Let's look at the banks. Let's look at banks first, okay? You guys all use banks, right? Listen to this little video. It's only like 2 seconds or 3 seconds.
Banks. Our deposits earn a measly 1% or less in a traditional bank, while they charge us between 6 and 30% when we borrow from them. This lopsided formula handicaps people from getting ahead financially. The average American family loses an average of 34.5% of every dollar earned in finance charges to this thief.
You put your money in the bank, they're going to give you less than 1%. And when you borrow money from them, they're going to charge you up to 30%. If you have a credit card. So most people lose about 35% of their money to the banks. Look at this right there. There's only one bank I know in Colorado that offers 1%. That's TCF Bank. Have you heard of that bank? TCF? 1%. I know you can't see it in the back, but let me help you read it here. Look at the fine print. You have to have $50,000 with them and keep it in their bank for 6 months for them to give you the 1%. 1%. If you don't have $50,000 or you can't keep your money 6 months in that bank locked up, you're probably going to be getting less than 0.25%. Ladies and gentlemen, think about this. The price of goods is going up. When you go out to eat, you're paying more money. When you buy groceries, you're paying more money. When you fill up your car, you're paying more money. In fact, they're saying that the cost of goods is growing by 4%. 4%. So if you have money in the local bank earning less than 1%, are you making or losing money? Just by having money where? In the bank. Well, financing is terrible. How many of you finance your purchases? All your purchases. Raise your hands. Okay, how about how many people pay cash? All right. I'm going to show you that financing or paying cash is the same. If you don't have the cash to pay cash for the purchase, you go to the local bank, right, and you borrow their money. Are they going to do it for free? No, they're going to charge you a finance charge. So you pay them interest. People that pay cash, they hate to make payments. They hate to pay the bank any interest. So they pay cash. So those people have money sitting around in an account, right? So when they take the money out of that account, they lose what? The money and the earning capacity, right? So if you look at it, it's the same thing. You either pay it or you lose it. I mean, banks have it really made, don't they? Let's look at this. And what I want you to do for me right now, so I want you to tell me what is most important to you when you're looking to borrow money. What do you want? What do you want on a loan? What is it? Why? Why do you want low interest rate? Okay, you've been taught to look for the lowest interest rate, right? Your parents, your grandparents, the school systems, they're always telling you, look for the lowest interest rate when you borrow money. I'm going to teach you something tonight. I want you to make a note of this. This is crucial. The APR, or the interest rate that you pay on a loan, is not that important. What's more important is the volume that you will pay over the life of the loan. That's what's going to kill your savings. That's what's going to deplete your retirement accounts. That's what's going to deplete your wealth. Now, take a look at this right here with me. This family is an actual family. They had only three items financed. Three: a car, a credit card, and a mortgage. The car was financed at 8.5%. But you see, that's APR. That's a lie. That's a myth. That's what the banks use to get you in the door. So whenever a bank reduces the rates, like for financing a home, everybody runs to what? Refinance, right? That's the interest that their people are taught to look for, the lowest interest rate. So look at this right here. Look at the car. Tell me, what is the monthly payment on that car? Okay, $594. I want you to take your calculators or your telephones out real quickly. I want to teach you something tonight. What is the monthly payment on that car, ladies and gentlemen? $490. How much? No, the monthly payment. How much is it? What's the monthly payment? $594. Everybody see that?
Yes.
What is the monthly interest charge on that payment every month? How much? $175, right?
Yes.
All right, so what I want you to do for me, I want you to please take $175 divided by $594 and tell me what you get.
A little over 29%.
30%. That's what you're really paying on interest, not the 8.5. So you see, an APR is a lie, it's a myth. But we're always taught to look for the lowest interest rate. That doesn't matter. This family was paying over $15,000 a year in finance charges on three items. This family would have paid over $300,000 if they would have kept their loans for 20 years. That's three items, ladies and gentlemen. How many people you know that may have more than one car financed? Or maybe have two or three credit cards or two homes? So you see, APR is a myth. Look at this. If you buy this from a bank, a home, how many of you have a home? When was the last time you looked at the closing statement on your home? You know, when you bought the house? I want you, if you haven't looked at it recently, do that for me. Take it out and read it. And I want you to know how much money you're going to pay the bank if you keep that loan for 20 or 30 years. And it doesn't matter what interest rate is the mortgage. It could be 1%. It could be 2%. It could be 3%. It doesn't matter. But you see, when you buy that from the bank, to a $200,000 home, if you keep it for 20 years, you would pay the bank for how much? Look at your closing statements. Is that 1%? Is that 2%? So the APR is a myth. That's banks. You got to protect your money from those greedy banks. I don't know, have you heard about Wells Fargo? What happened to them?
Yeah.
Oh, it's shameful. And they still have the CEO and the president there. Bonuses, multi-million dollars. I mean, what's wrong with that? Now, next thief is the government. Even though I love this country a lot, this thief can actually raise taxes. And no matter how much you're saving, if taxes are going up, you're going to lose a lot of money. So let's listen to this carefully.
Government. Our retirement plans are not safe. This thief can deplete our nest eggs through hefty taxation and can increase the tax rate at its own discretion at any time. Today, the average family loses an average of 36% of every dollar we earn in the form of income tax and all other taxes we pay daily, food, hotels, gas, etc.
36% of every dollar goes to pay taxes. You know what I mean by that? It's not only income tax that I'm talking about. When I called the Comfort Suites to reserve this room tonight, they quoted me a price over the phone. But when I leave tonight, guess what? I'm going to be paying more. Yep. Taxes. When I fill up my car with gas, I pay taxes. When I go to a restaurant, I pay taxes, right? So if you add up all the taxes that we pay, we're losing 36% of every dollar. How much were we losing to the banks because we were financing? 35%? Do the calculations. So take a look at this with me. And this is really an important exercise tonight. When you're looking to make money, what do you want? What are you looking for? When you're looking at an investment, what do you want? Who said that?
Return.
The high returns, right? Okay, remember when I said to you earlier, when you were looking to borrow money, what were you looking for? The low interest rates, right? Because that's the way you've been taught. I just showed you that that's not important anymore, right? On the other hand, when you're looking to make money, people think immediately, I want to have the highest rate of return. Why? Because you've been taught that. So if I can offer you 4%, and this gentleman can offer you 8, where would you go? Yeah, and somebody can offer you 10, where would you go? Because we have been taught to chase the high returns. That's a lie, again. That's a lie. What's most important is taxation. The way that that money, the way that that investment will be taxed. That is more important than the rate of return. Let me ask you one thing. What would be the greatest rate of return you could get? The greatest. I mean, you know, let's dream. 100%. Would you say that would be great? 100%? You're not going to get it. I can tell you that right now. But that would be a good exercise to play with tonight. 100% rate of return. All right. Who has a dollar bill? Is it really that bad? Anybody has a dollar bill? I mean, I'll give it back to you. Okay, come in and come over here. We're gonna play a game. Stand right here. What is your name?
Patrick.
Patrick. Now, Patrick heard that I could give him 100% rate of return. So he came to me with $1. And he says, Joe, I want to have that 100% rate of return. How much money would I have to give him in return? How much? So how much would that be? Okay, so he comes 1 year with $1, I'll have to give him 2, right? He says, I like that. So he comes a second year and he says, Joe, I have now $2. How many dollars will I have to give him?
4.
Make believe this is 4, Patrick. And then he comes the next year and he says, Joe, I want to keep doing this. I have $4 now. How much would I have to give him?
8.
And then he comes with 8, and I have to give him what?
16.
And then he comes with 16, I have to give him what?
32.
And so on. Let's give him a hand, please. Okay. How much will Patrick's dollar be worth in 20 years, you think, if we keep doing this game?
About half.
About half what? A dollar? Half a dollar? Half a dollar?
4%. You said 4%.
No, 100%. Oh, yeah. No. Okay. Let's look at this carefully. He keeps doing this for 20 years, and I keep doubling his money every year. Let's look at this. And I'm hoping you can see this in the back. But how much money would that dollar be worth in 20 years? Check my math. How much? Over $1 million. Over $1 million. That's the beauty of compound interest without what? Taxes. There's no taxes taken out. Now, you want to see what happens when Uncle Sam begins to tax you on this beautiful rate of return? And I'm going to use a tax bracket that is not really high. I'm going to use a tax bracket that is middle, like 17%. 17%. Let's see what happens to that $1 million, please. And if you're blessed and you're making more money today and you're in a higher tax bracket than 17%, let's look what happens at 27% tax bracket. What happens to that $1 million? I don't know about you, but I want to retire in the green. I don't want to retire there or the yellow or the red. How many of you have 401ks, IRAs? This is the way they're going to tax you. Okay? This is the way they're going to tax you. So you got to wonder, for whose benefit are those plans? The 401ks, the IRAs, are they for you and your family? No. It's for the government. So what's more important now to you, the rate of return or taxation? Look what happened to 100% rate of return. It was destroyed by taxation. How much rather have a 2% rate of return or a 3% rate of return tax-free? Right? All right. Taxes destroys the high yields. This guy here was pretty smart, don't you think? Einstein? He was the one who discovered compound interest. You know what that is, all of you? It's interest upon interest, right? But he said, those who understand compound interest will do what? Earn it. Those who don't understand compound interest will do what? And what are we doing, ladies and gentlemen? You're absolutely correct. You know why? Because when you go to the bank and you put money in the bank as a savings or a CD, they're paying you simple interest. When you borrow money from them, they're charging you compound interest. How many of you have credit cards? Your statements have a disclaimer on them. By law now, they have to tell you that if you only pay the minimum payment, it will take you a lifetime and a half to pay them off. Why? That's compound interest that you're paying. When you invest in the stock market, or you buy a bond or a mutual fund or a stock, they're giving you simple interest. Think about that. When you buy a house, you're paying compound interest. Does that make sense? Yep. So those who understand it will earn it. Those who don't understand it will pay it. And we're paying it. So where does your money really go? Stop and think about it. Let's summarize what we've been talking about. There you have a dollar bill. 34.5% will go to finance charges to the banks. 36% will go to taxes. And we're left with what? One-third of a dollar? See, this is why we have the worst savings rate in the world. Now, look at that dollar bill and tell me, if there was a strategy that could actually reduce those two areas, and instead of being here, you could be here, would you be better off? Would you use it? Would you take advantage of it? That's the key. You know why I say that? There was a study done, New York City, Central Park, somebody was handing out $100 bills to people passing by. Were you aware that some people did not take the $100? They just passed without taking the money because they thought, oh, there must be a catch. There's something wrong with it. So I want you to think about this. If there was such strategy that can actually help you financially, would you take advantage of it? So the next thief is ourselves right here, you and I. And let me tell you what I found out anyway, as to why people succeed while other people struggle financially. It's because three things. People, human beings in general, they procrastinate. Do you agree with that? This gentleman here, his name is Parkinson. Nothing to do with the disease that you hear about. He was an economist in the 1900s. He was the one that came up with the formula that said, if you give people 90 days to complete a job, when are they going to get it done? Because they procrastinate, right? What stays open till midnight, April the 15th, ladies and gentlemen? Because people procrastinate, right? When you procrastinate saving money or investing for retirement, you know what? Pretty soon you're going to be 65 and you're going to have nothing. Parkinson also said, expenses rise to equal income. How many of you have gotten a tax refund? What happened to it? It's gone, right? How many of you have gotten a pay raise? What happened to that money? Expenses rose to equal income, right? Because we live in what I call the instant gratification society. We want everything, everything, everything. And guess what? You don't have to have money to buy them, to buy those things. You can charge them, make the banks wealthy. Just go back to your own family roots. Did your parents or grandparents, if they didn't have the money, did they buy things? See, that was the older generations. This new generation, we have an instant gratification mentality. We want to buy everything. Does that make sense? And the next bullet is living beyond our means. Parkinson said, a luxury once enjoyed becomes a necessity. Luxury once enjoyed becomes a necessity. You know, I would say maybe 10 years ago, I bought a car with heated car seats. I love them in the wintertime. I mean, I love them. My wife will never let me buy another car without them. And we just got another car, and now it has heated steering wheel. I love that. I love it. So a luxury once enjoyed has become a necessity. I don't have to wear gloves anymore in the wintertime. Isn't that neat? What about this right here? What did we have 20 years ago? Pay phones, landlines, what else? Pagers, remember those pagers? My life is inside this little computer. Have you ever lost yours? Has it ever broken down on you? It happened to me about a month ago and I was going crazy. So a luxury, once enjoyed, has become a necessity. So what is the prescription to succeed and not struggle financially? This is what I came up with. And remember this, it's not what you're making that really matters. It's what you keep. We had the pleasure of meeting a lady in Loveland, Colorado about 6 months ago. We sat down with her. She came to the seminar. We sat down with her, and she told us that she had over $1 million in her 401k. Can you believe that? She brought her statements. So she did have over $1 million. And I said, what do you do? She says, I'm a checker at King Soopers. Amazing. How much do you make? Less than $35,000 a year. And she accumulated over $1.5 million. I seen that with my own eyes. And my son went with me. I said, how long have you been working at King Soopers? 35 years. There's the key. She saved money. She paid herself. Changed jobs or, you know, whatever. And she put money in. And within 35 years, she's set for life. Even though she has it in the wrong place, but $1.5 million is a lot of money, right? I can't say that. Ooh, don't get excited. All right. So it's not what you make. Does that make sense? It's what you keep. So you have to start thinking like that. Number two, you got to pay yourselves first. I like to emphasize that. Because see, all of you are working, right? And you work very hard. And you make money. And you put this money in a bank. Into your checking account. And you begin to do what? Write checks. To everybody that you owe money to. And you forget to pay who? And you're the one working. I call this economic slavery. You need to pay yourselves first. I don't care what it is. Whether it's 10% of what you're making, 20%, 25%, whatever you can, but make it mandatory to pay yourselves first. You're not going to change. You're not going to get ahead financially unless you do that. So that's the second point. You can start a business on the side if you like to add additional money. I learned that at a very early age in Iowa. I mean, I had 2 or 3 jobs, and I was able to accumulate money. So if you have the energy and you have the health, this is the land of opportunity. Start a side job. I got one of my clients told me that he's an engineer making a good income. And he started a business with vending machines. Now his vending machines are equaling the income that he's getting from his employer. How good is that? Do you think he feels pretty confident about the future? Of course. And don't give the money to the bank. We're going to show you a way that you can self-finance your purchases, like the wealthy have done in the past. So this is what I found as to why people succeed financially while other people struggle. And you see, I also believe that you need to have internal motivation to change. You know what I mean by that? Something has to drive you to change. I just wrote a book. It's called The Why Factor. And after a lot of research, I found my own why. Why did I really want to succeed? Well, think about it this way. My mother, bless her soul, she let me come to the United States when I was 12 years old. How many of you are parents? How would that impact your life if you let your child leave at that age to better himself? I know that she suffered a lot. She suffered a lot. She wasn't the same person, but she wanted me to succeed. So my why is to make sure that I didn't let her down, that her suffering didn't go in vain. What if I would have been one of those people holding a sign, unemployed? See, all her suffering would have gone down by the wayside. So what is your why? What is really your why? What is it that you need to have that is driving you to achieve, to change financially? So that was my why. I want you to look at your why. Then the last thief, guess what? It's Wall Street. How many of you are invested in the market? You know, let me tell you about the market. I believe the market is nothing more than a casino. How many of you seen the opening of the stock market and on TV? What do you hear? Okay, what do you hear when you walk out of the plane in Las Vegas, Nevada? It's all the same. The stock market, Wall Street, is the house. Las Vegas, the casino, is the house. They're against you. You're not going to be making money. I can tell you that right now. You may win a little bit to tease you, but you're going to lose money. And that's what's happening to people. So pay attention to this.
Wall Street. This thief has been made the center of attention as a fraud. Unpredictable stock market crashes, the mortgage collapse, and unethical brokers have been storylines for movies such as The Big Short, Enron, and many more. The stock market is gambling. Would you take all of your retirement money to Las Vegas and gamble it away to this thief?
Would you take everything you own and just put that on the table? That's what we're doing. So, Wall Street. If your account, even your 401ks or IRAs, if they drop by those percentages right there, the stock market has to do what's on the green just to get you back to even, not to make any money. Now, in 2008, when we had that dip on the stock market, people lost between 37 and 50% of their accounts. I mean, we had people come to our office crying with tears in their eyes because they lost half of their accounts. We have met pilots from United Airlines that lost everything and they can't retire anymore at that age. So they have to continue to work. So if the market drops by 50%, the market has to increase by 100% just to get you back to where you were before you lost the money. Think about it. And when was the last time that the stock market did 100%? Let me give you a clue. Never. So, and the sad part about this thief is that people representing this thief, they get paid whether you make or lose money. Can you believe that? The brokers that you have, the financial advisors that sell you the stocks, bonds, and mutual funds, if your account goes down, they don't care because they're still making money. When I was doing a segment on Colorado's Best, as the financial expert, Paula, I think you remember this, a lady called in, Audrey is her name, and she said to me, please help me, I'm bleeding to death financially. She told us a story, and we were so impressed with that that we actually filmed that. And I want you to actually listen to her as to what happened to her with this thief right here. And by the way, she's 72 years old.
He put everything in the stocks and some into an IRA for me. And when I got my statements month after month, I started freaking because I kept losing money. It's minus, minus, and after 2.5 years, I was just hemorrhaging money. And I was getting very scared. So I was looking at your program, and I love your program, by the way. And Joe Quijano was on there, and I said, he sounds like a great person. He has a great idea. I liked what he said.
When she called me, she said, please help me.
Yes.
I'm bleeding to death.
Financially, and I was. I'm not that young. I'm 72, and I'm not that young. And I have to have money for the rest of my life. And I want to put my grandchildren through school. They're both wonderful children. I just can't tell you enough about them. They're so great. I love them so much. And I want to put them through school because I know it's going to be hard for mommy. She's a single parent. And I don't think daddy's going to contribute that much either. So I said, I have the money. At least I did have it when I first came here. Lost a lot, but Joe's helping me there, and I think I'm going to have the money now to put them through school.
72 years old. Let me tell you her background. She came from Pennsylvania. Her husband died. She's a widow. The husband left her a death benefit. They sold her family home to travel here to be with her daughter. She had about a little bit over $3 million when she got here. When she came to Colorado, she did what most people would do. She went to Wells Fargo, that's number one. Big mistake, right? And number two, she went to Belco Credit Union. Their financial people took all her money, get this, and put it in the stock market. Okay? Now, she lost over $2 million. Yet, those people that sold her that, they made money. What's wrong with that? What is wrong with that? So do you think we need to rescue our financial dreams from this economy, from this thieves that we are facing? Become the banker, and again, it's only strategy, that really is a very simple program, has a very simple formula that anybody can use. And it will let you keep your money even after you think you have spent it. Think about it again. It's a simple plan, simple formula. It will allow you to keep your money even after you think you have spent it. And it's going to give you a predictable, nothing to do with the stock market, a predictable rate of return. You will never lose money. To become your own banker, you need to know how a bank, a traditional bank, really works. Now, we use it, right? We use banks. So let's look at a bank, a traditional bank. What is a bank, by the way? What's a bank? A depository. That's right. Some people call it a warehouse. It's only a pool of money, right? So when you put money in the local bank, they're called deposits. They're going to give you a very low interest rate. You're going to be taxed on the yield. So why do people use it? Well, it's convenient and it's liquid. Now, but when you go borrow money from that bank, you're going to have to prove to the banker. You have to prove to the banker that you don't need the money for them to give it to you. It's the most humiliating experience in the world. And if they do give you a loan, they're going to ask you to repay it by contract. And if you don't pay them back, what happens? Repossess, foreclosures, and they will ruin your credit, right? But when they give you a loan, they're going to charge you interest, which is between 6 or 9%. And they're giving you less than 1%. So how would you like to become the banker? They're making money, right? So for you to become your own banker, all you got to do is find another source of money supply. You need to find another alternative pool of money. And the become the banker strategy uses a product that acts like a bank, and it's under the Internal Revenue Code 7702, which is tax-free. Tax-free. So when you put money into this pool of money, they're called contributions, you're going to be getting a 4%, ladies and gentlemen, guaranteed and tax-free rate of return, liquid, with no penalties if you take your money out. Okay. Now, when you borrow money from this pool of money, which you own, basically, are you going to check your own credits? That's right. You don't have to. That's what the wealthy have done in the past. They built banks, family banks. So when you borrow money, you don't have to check your credit. You create a contract between you and yourself only, not the bank or the government. So you can make your own payments however you want to make them. If for some reason something happens to you that you lose your employment and you don't have the money to pay your loan that you got from yourself, you're not going to foreclose on your home. You're not going to repossess the purchase, right? All you do is just extend the loan and pay whenever you can. See, that's the beauty of you becoming your own banker. You have control. Does that make sense? So what is this product? What is the product that we use? It's really time-tested. It's been around for 200 years. It's tax-free, approved by the IRS code 7702, is guaranteed and safe. That means that this product will never lose money. It will always grow for you. It offers a 4% rate of return. There's no stock market volatility, so you don't have to worry about the stock market. And it's liquid. You can use it and you control it. That's the product. Now, what I want you to do, though, today, I want you to disregard conventional wisdom, because conventional wisdom has been wrong. Am I right? We proved that to you tonight. How about if you were looking for a loan, what were you looking for? What were you looking for an investment? That's wrong. That's conventional wisdom. So tonight, I want you to disregard what you've been taught, because the product that we use, it's a very specialized life insurance policy. That's what they call Section 7702. This is not the type of life insurance that you are probably aware of. This is not like your parents' life insurance policies. This is not like your employer's life insurance policy. This is not like the policies you can buy from New York Life, Northwestern Mutual, State Farm, or Allstate. This is a very unique life insurance policy that is specifically designed to act like a bank for you. Okay? I want you to kind of look at the last bullet here. I want you to get past the name, life insurance, and just concentrate tonight on what it can do for you. Most people have a negative connotation of life insurance, because people may say, I have to die for the policy to pay. This is not that type of policy. This policy will pay if you live. It's a living policy, not a death policy. So get past the name and concentrate on what it can do for you. So let's take a look at it. Let's compare it. I know this is something that you can't see in the back. Or can you see those letters in the back? Okay. Sir, you mind if you just go ahead and read them? This is what consumers want. This is what consumers want on a given investment.
Tax-free death benefit.
Tax-free death benefit.
Tax-deferred growth.
Tax-deferred growth.
Tax-free access to the money.
Tax-free access.
Competitive rate of return.
Competitive rate of return.
Guarantees. Credit protection.
Creditor protection.
Unlimited contribution.
Unlimited contribution.
Liquidity use control.
Liquidity use and control. Now, that's what most consumers want on any given investment. So let's look at what investments match up to that. Here you have stocks, bonds, mutual funds, CDs, 401ks, tax-free bonds, and real estate. Let's see how it compares. Not one has all the check marks. You see that right there? Not one. But if you put this new modern, specifically designed life insurance policy, it has every single thing that a consumer wants. So get past the name and concentrate on what it can do for you. Follow the people before you. These people here have used the Become the Banker strategy. At one point in time, it used to be the secret of the wealthy. It's no longer the secret of the wealthy. And anybody can use it. You don't have to be wealthy to use this. But the wealthy kept it as a secret. They built family banks. Walt Disney built Disneyland with the Become the Banker strategy. If you look all the way to this gentleman right here, the ex-chairman of the Federal Reserve, Ben Bernanke, uses the Become the Banker strategy. not only to make money, but to protect what he has. Now, think about it for a moment. He was the one that controlled the entire money supply of this country. If it's good enough for him, it should be good enough for all of us, right? And that's life insurance, but specifically designed. How many of you are from Colorado, by the way? Born and raised? Okay, have you heard of, okay, can I ask you a question? Have you heard of the Boettcher family? Would you say they're wealthy? They have the Boettcher Foundation, the Boettcher Hall, you know, they have scholarships, etc. They're multi-billionaires. What happened in 1929, ladies and gentlemen, in this country? The stock market crashed, the worst crash in history, right? The market crumbled down to its knees. There were soup lines being formed. People lost everything they had. They lost their dreams, they lost their money, and they lost their lives because people committed suicide. 1929. Banks failed. The stock market failed. Yet, Mr. Boettcher from Colorado, this came from the Denver Business Journal, and you have a reprint on your packet. Mr. Boettcher, in 1929, he borrowed how much money from his life insurance policy? $2 million from his life insurance policy. Keep in mind, Mr. Boettcher was not dead. He was alive. He borrowed $2 million from his life insurance policy. So what does that tell you? He was investing money in life insurance. Like the wealthy, not the stock market, not the banks, but life insurance. So when the market went down and the banks failed, he had access to how much money? $2 million in 1929. How much money would that be today? You know what he did with this money? He bought stock because the prices were low, right? The market crashed. He waited a couple of years. The market went up. And the family became known as the Boettcher family, the wealthy Boettcher family. All because of what? Life insurance. Not the stock market, not savings. So get past the name. Now, you can do a lot of wonderful things with this plan. You can finance homes. You can finance investment property. You can finance vacations. You can finance anything you want. So I did an example here on how you can finance a car, because everybody has a car, right? And I'm going to show you how much money you can make by financing your own cars through your own personal bank. So let's take a look at this. There's a car, but I want you to do me a favor tonight, though. Right now, I want you to switch hats. I don't want you to think as a consumer. I want you to please think as a banker. Fair enough? And I'm going to guide you. This car is $50,000. Here's the terms. We're going to choose 7 years. If you were a consumer, what would you say about that? Well, that's a long time, right? If you were a banker, what would you say? All right. Now, APR. You know that's a myth. But as a consumer, you may say 8.5%. I could get one for maybe 3, right? As a banker, what would you say? All right. Now, you're the banker now. So we're going to have a monthly payment of $778 per month. As a consumer, you shake your head, right? As a banker, you would welcome that, right? Let me show you why it makes all the difference to think as a banker. There's two options. Say you have to finance this car. You go to the local bank like Wells Fargo, or you can go through your own life insurance bank. Okay? That's the two options. Let's take a look at them. The monthly payment of $778, if you were to finance the car through the bank, Wells Fargo Bank, let's say, where's the payment going to go? Is it going to go like that, right? Would you ever see that money back again? No. I mean, I've been financing cars all my life, and I have yet to have a bank send me any money. On the other hand, if you finance that car like Mr. Betcher took out a loan from his life insurance policy through your own personal bank, where is the 778 going to go? How would you feel? You're not losing money to the bank. You're making money that the banks are making. So let's look at it at the end of 7 years under both methods. Under both methods, do you agree that you still have a car? But it's depreciated, right? We all know that. So the car now is worth about $10,500. Can you believe that? Under both methods, how much did we pay for that car? $65,422. How did we come up with that figure? Well, there's the principal and there's the interest, right? If you finance it through your own life insurance personal bank, guess what you're going to do? You're going to recover the principal and the interest, so you would get that money back. How good is that? Because you paid yourself back, right? Plus you have, what else you have? The car. So between all those three things, you would make almost $76,000 financing a $50,000 car. If you finance it through the bank, how much would you have? Only that car, right? That $10,500. So it's not really rocket science, ladies and gentlemen. So my question to you would be, what would you rather have? Only the car or the car and the money? And you can do the same thing with anything. Now, for the folks watching at home tonight, I'm going to give you a code to redeem. It's called BTB1. B, that letter B like boy, T like Tom, B like boy, number one. Okay? Now, isn't that neat, financing that? So I'm going to tell you something real quickly, and that is you can use that Become the Banker not only to help you, but to help your family. I have 6 children, and I didn't want to have them make the mistakes that I have made financially. So when I first learned about this beautiful strategy almost 20 years ago now, I sat down with all my children, and I taught them a lesson on the Become the Banker. And what I want to do is I want to have my youngest son, which I'm really proud of, because he actually joined me as a financial advisor close to 5 years ago now, and he can tell you what it has meant for him to be taught this lesson. So can we welcome Jordan, please?
So I'm Jordan. I probably spoke to most of you guys on the phone. And my first experience with Become the Banker was actually when I was 16 years old. I was looking to purchase my first vehicle, as most of us are at that age. And my father, like he said, he sat me down and he really taught me the power and the benefit of having this strategy. You know, at that age, I went to him and said, "Dad, I found a perfect Jeep, 1999 Jeep Grand Cherokee Laredo, 130,000 miles on it. How can we get this?" As most kids say, right? But he sat me down and said, "How are you going to get this? You're going to have to get a job, keep up with payments and maintenance." But he said, "Jordan, I'll save you one step. I started this policy on you when you were a child, just like with your brother and your sisters, and I'll allow you to use it to finance your own car through yourself." Well, I said, "That sounds like a pretty good deal." And so he sat me down. He said, "3 years. By the age of 19, I want you to have the loan paid off." Being young and spending money frivolously, I definitely extended that out to maybe 19 and a half, because there were some months that I didn't have the funds. And that didn't ding my credit. It didn't repossess my item. I was able just to extend the payments out because I was the banker. Now,
can you speak louder?
Oh, absolutely, sorry. Now, for me, I drove that Jeep all the way up to age 19, 23 actually. And the Jeep gave out 230,000 miles. And my mechanic said, "Stop, you're putting too much money into this. It's time for a new vehicle." So what I did is I went to my father and said, "What do I have in the account now? Now that I've had that interest working for me, compounding at the 4% with the dividends, what do I have now?" And I was able to finance my Infiniti outside with the same process. I had to call the First Bank of Littleton, ask what monthly payment and what interest rate they would have charged me had I gone through them. And all I did was make that same payment back to myself so that I made all the money that they would have made off of me. Now, this works great for college education. It works great for buying homes, down payments. And we're about to show you on the next slide here. Give the clicker. Oh, pardon me. How this really works. So this next slide to me is the most important one. So please pay attention here, folks, and the ones at home. Now let's say that you build up your policy with $20,000 of cash, all right?
Is your mic on?
It should be. But yeah, there's a light on the bottom, thank you. But with the car, you can purchase anything, you know, whether it be a car, a vacation. So let's say you have $20,000 in your policy and you want to finance a car through yourself. Most people think that that money comes from your policy. That's not the case. It'll come from the life insurance company's general account. So you still have how much in your account then? $20,000, growing at 4%, earning dividends. Now, the life insurance company, they're gonna cut you a check for that $10,000. And they'll put a lien against your 20, or against 10 of the 20. But the key thing is, do you think they're gonna do it for free? Sadly not. Most people make money these days, right? But it's what's in the green that's really important. They charge simple interest on that loan once a year, and it's 4.76%. So let's just say it was $1,000 that you borrowed. 4.76% of that would be $47, let's call it $50 for the whole year. $50 for the whole year on that loan. And being that's declining balance, let's say that you carry $900 over to the second year. 5% on that is $45 for that whole year. So you can really see the interest they're charging you isn't that much at all. But this is where the power of Become the Banker comes into play. You don't want to just stop at that simple interest. You want to charge yourself what anybody else would have charged you. So let's say you charge yourself 10%. The first 5% will go back to the company to pay off the loan and release that lien. And the additional 5% that you pay yourself goes to who? To your account, adding on top of the interest you're making already. So you can really see this is where it snowball effects. Now, we're gonna actually jump into a slide here that's gonna show you some true figures, so that way you guys can see the benefit of it.
Thank you, Jordan. Let's give him a hand for something. But you know, that's the beauty of it. I mean, you build a pool of money, and then if you wanna buy something or finance something through your bank, you take a policy loan, the company will give you that check, they put a lien against your policy, obviously, and then you pay yourself back at a higher interest rate that the company's charging you. So your money in your policy still remains intact and is growing at the 4% plus whatever extra that you want to put in. So by financing your own purchases, you can make a lot of money. You can make the money that the banks would have made off of you. Look in your packets, please. I bet you have the same thing that we're going to show you, just in case you can't see it. Back there, it should be on the handouts. First of all, you'll see a handout right here with Mr. Betcher, the article of Mr. Betcher. You see it right there. Open it up. And you'll see the illustration that we're going to show you right here. Okay, so you pay attention. This Become the Banker strategy works with any amount of money that you want to put in. The more you put in, the better it looks, okay? So we just chose at random a $10,000 a year contribution. Okay, that's $10,000 a year. And this gentleman only wanted to put in the money into his personal bank only for 7 years. With this type of policy, you don't have to contribute for the rest of your life unless you want to. He chose to only pay for 7 years to himself. So let's look at line number one. Look at the top right here. The two columns on your right, one of them is called the net cash value. That is the pool of money that is accessible to you day one. And the next column is called the death benefit. That would be what your family would get in case the unexpected happens to you. So let's take a look at what happens to the $10,000 premium. Year number one, the client puts $10,000. How much money can he have access to year one? How much? Almost 80, let's say call it $8,400. That's pretty liquid, don't you think? Now, if he were to pass away, what's the death benefit year number one? Almost $256,000. Taxable or tax-free?
Tax-free.
That is right. Now, if you were to put that same amount of money at the local bank, or in the stock market or whatever, and you would have died, how much is the bank going to pay your family? $10,000, right? Mm-hmm. All right. Now, let's go all the way to year number seven, please. Year number seven, he stops making his contributions. So he put $10,000 a year for 7 years. How much money is that?
70.
Thank you. How much money does he have available in 7 years?
A little under 70.
How much? Almost all of it, right? 99%. And what about if he were to pass away, how much money will his family get? All right. Now, look at the column that says loan. Beginning on year number eight, he wants to borrow $10,000. And he wants to borrow $10,000 every 3 years. Every 3 years, he wants to borrow money. We want to encourage people to borrow money. That's how the policy grows, okay? And he pays himself back $300 per month or $3,600 per year. You see that on the left right there on the loan? Let's go to age 65 or line 25 and tell me how much money he has available to him.
123, almost 124. $124,000,
ladies and gentlemen. And how much money did he put in total? Is that a good return? Then beginning at age 66, you see that $10,000 income stream? That means that he's taking out $10,000 a year, tax-free for the rest of his life. So this policy is almost like a multi-purpose policy. You know, it offers money for opportunities, money for emergencies, right? And then at the end, it offers money for retirement. And if you happen to pass away, it offers security for your family. It's an amazing tool. Amazing tool that the wealthy have known for years. So what I want you to concentrate on is something real quickly here. This is not rocket science. This is not the stock market. This is not any complicated formula. This is something that has been proven. It's been tested. It's over 200 years old. The wealthy have known about it. And I like to share this cartoon with you because I love it. Have you seen those birds on a wire? And this little bird is falling down, and the other two are laughing. And they're talking to themselves, says, hey, you're overthinking it, Phil. I don't want you to overthink this. There's nothing to overthink with this. It is what it is. It's life insurance. It's actuarially sound. It's approved by the IRS. It's under U.S. tax law. So you don't have to overthink it. So what you do today will determine where you will be 5 to 10 years in the future. Remember what I said at the beginning? Procrastination depletes wealth. What you do and what you learn today will determine where you will be 5 years from now. Now, we have had people that have attended our seminars 5 years ago that are finally coming to us, and their comment has been, I wish I would have done this 5 years ago. I would have been 5 years younger, and I would have been accumulating money instead of losing money. Don't lose any more money. You see this form right here? It's on your packet. This form is probably one of the most important forms that you can complete tonight. And that is, are you ready to find out if this is really for you? What I want you to do is to complete it and hand it to one of us, either myself, my son, Randy, Sarah, or Carlos. And this will give us the opportunity to give you a call and sit down with you individually and find out if this is really for you. There's no fee. There's no obligation. But see, it deals with your finances. And we don't want to talk about your finances in public. So complete it. Take the first step to do the change and hand it to us, and we'll sit down and chat. Now, at this point, while you're doing that, and a lot of people have told us that the best part of the seminar is the questions and answers. They get a lot from it. So if you could please help us and help the attendees that we have here, and as well as the people watching from home, with any questions that you may have. And then I'll try to give you the answers. Yes?
I have a comment and a question.
Okay.
First of all, in order to get your money out, to put the money into an insurance, it looks like an insurance policy, how do you get, is it a tax cover, you know, like when you want
to
roll over? Is that what it
is? Yeah. Now say that again, please.
If you want to take the money out of your stock without being penalized and put it in an insurance policy, is there a taxable...
That's a very good question, okay? What she's asking is that you probably have some stocks in a 401k or IRA, right, that has not been taxed. Wouldn't it be nice if the government will allow you to just roll that over into a life insurance policy? See, that would be beautiful, right? But they're not that kind because they haven't gotten paid their taxes. So that's illegal. You cannot do that. So in other words, you have to cash it in. And if you're over 59 and a half, you don't have to pay the 10% penalty. If you're under 59 and a half, you do have to pay a 10% penalty plus the tax. So if you're over 59 and a half, you know, you may be, it's something that we have to discuss individually, but I mean, you may be better off doing it, cashing it in, because taxes are on sale today. They're gonna go up in the future, so if you wait to do this later, you're probably gonna be paying more in taxes.
Is there room for a comment?
Yes.
I actually did what you suggested, but only half of it. My husband said, if you can find money to remodel, then do it. We'll do it. So I borrowed into our insurance policy and then paid it back. What I wished I had done was also paid myself back.
Good job.
And it cost us a lot less than borrowing the money for remodel.
So you understand the beauty behind this.
Yeah.
So get another one. Get another one. The more the better. Anybody else, please? Any other questions?
Excuse me.
Yes.
In your presentation, you've used the number of 4% return.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not seeing that anywhere in your layout.
Here. Right. It's a 4% gross rate of return. All the values are based on 4%. There's the cost of insurance that has to be taken out. So you're not going to see... You're not going to see a true 4% because it's a gross rate of return.
Follow up then, is there a contractual obligation to pay 4%?
Yes, it's on the policy. It's on black and white. All the values are based on 4% gross rate of return. Okay? Anybody else, please?
So because it's not a U.S. tax code per se, it's a U.S. code 7702, I understand, but it's not guaranteed by the federal government.
Good question. First of all, it is a tax code.
7702
is a tax code, okay?
That's a revenue code.
That governs life insurance. And the meaning of the 7702 tax code is actually that it's tax-free. It exempts life insurance from being taxed. So that's what it is. Guaranteed by the government.
Is not.
No. But I tell you what, it's safer than most banks, because every state has what they call an insurance department. Am I right? So if a company has any financial difficulties, the first thing that happens is that the commissioner of insurance will actually find a company to merge the company with. And all the promises that the initial company made to people like you, they have to keep. Now, if for some reason they can't find a company to merge the company with, then the state has what they call a guarantee pool of money that every company participates in. It's called the guaranteed association, where they will actually guarantee your death benefit and your cash value up to a certain dollar amount. So it's pretty strong. And you got to remember, life insurance has been around for 200 years. Yes, over that. Yes.
Is there a certain amount to get it started?
It's whatever you feel. The question is certain amounts to get started. Really, it's totally up to you. It's just like I said, the more you put in, the better it works. The less you put in, the longer it takes. So just remember what I said at the very beginning. Pay yourselves first. Whatever you're making right now, take a percentage of that and at least say to yourself, I'm going to pay myself first. And put the money where you're not going to lose it here. Okay? I know there was somebody else here.
You know, Joe, when
yes.
You were giving an example of how you can raise the money to start a life, an insurance, you use the example of the engineer who made a good salary, but he started a vending machine business.
Right.
You know, that reminds me of the lyrics to a song that addresses that very issue.
Really?
And the lyrics, you ought to really look it up.
Okay.
The lyrics are by Ray Charles.
Wow.
And it goes something like this. It says, them that's got are them that gets. But how you get the first is a mystery to me.
Very good. I like that. Thank you.
And that's been out 20 years.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Look it up.
Yeah, I will. I will.
And it'll have you dancing.
Well, my gosh. I tell you what. This thing has me dancing with that lyrics. But you know what? I like that.
Yeah.
I like that very much. You had a question, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Say you have like $20,000 in the policy and you want to borrow money for like something like $30,000. Can you borrow more than what
no,
you have?
No. See, that would be too good to
okay.
be true. So this is not a gimmick. This is not a gimmick, and this is not too good to be true. You can only borrow what you have.
Okay.
Okay?
And
you can only borrow what you have.
And do you borrow, is the life insurance, do you, is it to a company? Do you put the money in a random company, or do you choose what company?
No. We actually have, there's only a handful of companies that actually do policies like this.
Okay.
And we represent those companies. So we will choose the right company for you, the one that fits you, just like a tailor-made suit. Okay?
Okay.
Yes, sir.
I've got another question. Being you got a banker up there.
Say that again?
Being you got that become a banker, talk about banks.
Yes.
And little Bush Jr. signed a law before he got out.
Bush Jr.
and we can go ahead and stick your little bit of money in the bank to pay your bills, whatever, but the country gets in big trouble, as it is not now, so they say. Well, what happens, they broke the law, says we could come in, seize your account, take everything you got in the bank, and all you will be is a depositor and nothing else.
Right. Yeah.
That's our great government.
No, that's the fear that we have to have.
That's the fear.
Since it is life insurance, what about qualifications, age? What if people are worried about that?
Yeah, a lot of people ask, you know, a couple of things here. I think this is really important to really understand. It is life insurance. So people have to qualify health-wise and age-wise, okay? But with the Become the Banker strategy, listen carefully, because this is different. The Become the Banker is different. Even though you may not be healthy or you may be older, you can still be the bank or your banker and put the insurance on somebody else that's healthy within your family. In other words, like myself, I put the insurance on who? My son. He has the insurance. He's the youngster, right? So he has the insurance, but I own what? The policy. I put the money in, and did you catch it when he was saying that he came to who to get the loan? He came to the bank. I'm the banker, see? I control it. And so I did that with all my children. Yes, ma'am.
By doing that, would that affect their tax bracket in any way?
No, not at all. I'm the owner of the policy. They're just insured. Okay, so it will not do anything to their tax bracket. They don't own the policy. I'm the owner. Okay, so like for example, I actually have 9 policies. I have 2 on myself, 1 on my wife, and 1 on each one of my children. I control all 9 banks. So what happens when a bank becomes really good? What did they open? Branches, right? That's why there's branches all over. Every corner there's a branch, right? Well, I have 9 branches. If I need money, I can go to all my 9 banks, borrow the money, and then pay them back.
Joe, you may have answered this.
So.
But when you expire, what is the tax liability on them, on your heirs?
Good question. When you expire, when you graduate to the most beautiful world, right?
Absolutely.
He's asking, what is the tax liability to your heirs? Nothing. You know why? It's under 7702, which is the tax code that regulates life insurance as being tax-free. I'm not talking about tax deferred. I'm talking about tax free. No taxes. So when you leave a death benefit, your heirs will not have to pay taxes on it. When you leave a stock market account, they pay taxes on it. When you leave a CD, they'll pay taxes on it. When you leave a home, they'll pay taxes on it. Life insurance, tax free. It's a beautiful. Oh, beautiful. Anybody else, please? Yes.
You got me going.
Good.
Being healthy.
Yeah.
Because what if I don't qualify?
Well, you know, we're not the medical underwriting department, so don't count yourself out, okay? Because those companies are very lenient. But if you don't, for some reason, qualify, then you can put the insurance on somebody, a blood relative. Do you have any children?
Yes.
Put them on the children.
Business partners.
Sisters? Put them in there. See, once you get the hang of this, you're going to be putting life insurance on almost everybody you know. Except, I mean, they have to be relatives. Bloodline.
So can they control the money? Your money? Wait, so you have a child.
No.
And you put it in her name, and then say she goes, you know, she does something nutty. Mm-hmm. Can she go because it's in her name, is it, will it be in her name, no, or will it still be?
In your name. So okay, that's a beauty. You don't have to give the ownership away until you want to. Like, I still have the ownership on his policy. Okay. So, you know, when I'm good and ready, mm-hmm, I'll sign the ownership to him, but not now.
Okay.
So,
strong lesson, right?
What's that?
A strong lesson to teach the children not to spend.
Oh, money, absolutely. Right? It's a strong lesson. I mean, you know, you control the bank.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It's just beautiful.
But Joe, what happens? Don't take this personal.
No, please.
What happens if he expires?
Oh yeah.
Before you.
Yeah. Well, then I get the benefit. Sorry about that. I get the death benefit. No,
I tried to
but that doesn't really that to me is not even my mentality. But I mean, he has the insurance. I'm the beneficiary.
Yeah. Okay.
Tax free. All right, anybody else, please? Hey, listen, it's been wonderful. Complete the form, please. Do something to change your financial course. And the people watching at home, there's a form that you can actually complete online. Go ahead and send it in, please, okay? I really want you to know that I have really enjoyed being with you tonight.
I have one last question, okay, if I may.
Okay.
Can you give us some idea of, and I know everybody wants to know the answer to this question, what your consultant fees are when we come and have a private consultation?
Okay, that's very good, okay? There's no fee. I don't get paid as a, I don't have a fee, okay? The companies that I represent pay me. So you don't pay me. Okay? So there's no fee. Do you have a question?
Kind of, but I don't know. I have 3 grandchildren. I already have policies on all of them.
Okay. Good.
And I have a son, and I have a policy on him.
Very good. You know what you can do with that?
No, that's right.
You can actually roll them over into this type of policy, and without losing anything. It's what they call a 1035 tax-free exchange. So if you have policies on somebody, you can just roll them over into the newer type of policies like this, which, by the way, I can assure you that they're better. Well, did that make sense? Okay, well, ladies and gentlemen, I really want to thank you for spending, you know, a couple of hours with me today. I have enjoyed it. Did you learn something?
Yes.
Did you enjoy it?
Yes.
Well, thank you so much. Appreciate it, okay? Thank you.